will certainly go wrong. So having that in mind, I thought, let me inquire into this area. And I have made my presentation surrounding these key concepts. Primarily, since it's the 10th schedule, deals with defections, we are talking about democracy. We are also talking about representations of people and the will of the people. We are talking about the legitimate authority to govern. And that's the most important part of it, that from where do we derive, where do the political leaders or the state gets authority from? And how much of the representation of the people's will comes in over there? So going to the first idea, that's of democracy, I need not reiterate its importance. We all know how important it is, and we have all subscribed to it. But it'll be very interesting to note that democracy at every point of time did not have so much of did not bring so much of appeal in people. Okay, if you look at Plato's work, we find that he preferred more aristocracy, monarchy, because all his theory ran around that whole thing that, the leader has to be a philosopher. He has to be able to reason. He has to be able to clearly understand the problems of the people, know what are the interests that are there, the conflicting interests, and with his reason and with his wisdom, he'll be able to give whatever would be the best of the law. So he thought that, instead of giving everybody the power to rule, it would be better that if we stick by aristocracy. In democracy also did not find support in a lot of other works of, say, for example, Hobbes, wherein you find that he says that, any expert can win an election. You can be popular for a lot many different reasons apart from the right reason all the time. People may not understand that, what is right and what is wrong. And a popular person is the person who generally gets elected. But we have come apart, a lot apart from that particular stage to the present, and wherein we have built our laws, we have stitched our laws around it so well that we have come up with a very good idea of democracy. If you see strategically, democracy has an advantage. It has a distinct advantage because it forces decision makers to take into account the interests and the rights and the opinions of the most of the people in the society. Democracy also gives some political power to each, and more people are taken into account than if you compare as against, aristocracy or a monarchy. In the recent works, if you look at Amartya Sen's 1999 work, you'll find that he gives a stamp of approval to democracy. He goes on to state that, no substantial famine has ever occurred in any independent country with a democratic form of government and a relatively free press. So he goes on to say that where people have a say, all the problems can be discussed and there can be solutions to those problems. So democratic decision making tends to be, more informed. It is more, discussed and deliberated upon and then concluded. So it will go more in the right direction. Looking at the next idea, that is about from where does the justification and legitimacy of political authority arises? Primarily, it derives from the fact that the elected representative has the support of the electorate of his constituency. If he wouldn't have that support, he wouldn't have the authority to govern us. So its underlying idea is the consent of the people, is the approval of the people to the to that particular person who has the permission of the people to govern that group of people. So it and then follows the establishment of institutions. So there is a government that is formed, there are institutions that are framed, and in these institutions, there are people who occupy various offices. And these offices subscribe to the constitution. They have an obligation to abide by the constitution. So what you see is we the people give to ourselves this constitution, and then we allow the constitution and its functionaries to rule over us as per the constitution. But what you see is primarily whenever there is an election has happened and the election is done and the results are out and there is no clear majority for one particular political party, what we see is, spanning out of the law of the nature. And in the law of the nature has been explained very beautifully by various philosophers. We did not get into that, but primarily it's the tussle for power. It is that I want to be the person who wants to form the government, and I want to get into the power. And then there is no discussion at all about, the law also does not explain what is constitution, what is mandate of the constitution, right? What is people's mandate? And this is the word that constantly keeps coming up at that point of time. Everybody wants to say that I have the mandate of the people, I have the approval of the people, the support of the people. And completely, we put all of that, the leaders who are right now at that point of time involved in that power struggle. What's happening over there is, forming of alliances, forming, groups, and horse trading, and all that problem that we are dealing with today, coming together to say that I have the support of most of the people. So we completely forget about who's the party who got the most number of seats. It's who are the group of parties who will come together and show that, magic number. So the retarding value that a legal system adds is by, bringing the idea of justice. So what happens is, you'll see this in the Republic mentioned very clearly, that in that law of nature, what seems to be true is the law of the mighty, right? And that seems to be the law. But then, so Plato puts his words through Socrates' mouth, and he says that no, there is an element of justice. I need to bring that in. And in that power struggle, there is that weak person who needs to be taken care of, and there evolves the idea of justice. And then we have these set of laws that says that no, you can't do this, you can do this, you cannot do this, right? So taking care of that vulnerable population. Now, with respect to the Anti-Defection Act, when you look at this, the whole idea of Anti-Defection Act is to bring about more stability. Now, in that process of bringing in or having more stability in the parliament, are we somewhere forgetting the people at large? Is what we need to see. Apart from the legislature, also there is the judiciary, right? And in the goals of the judiciary, if you see, is upholding the constitution. The main role of the judiciary is upholding the constitution. It's about safeguarding the values that the constitution has given us, particularly in the preamble. And there is this word justice, socio-economic and political, though that political justice is not defined. We see to it that the judiciary sees to it that nobody tries to subvert the constitutional values or makes, any fraud on the constitution. Now, when we see in this Anti-Defection Act, how does this pan out? What we see is there is a lot of the constitution is there. There is the Representation of People's Act. There is this Anti-Defection Act, the 10th schedule as well. And there is a whole bunch of constitutional conventions as well, which also a lot of time the court is called upon to rule upon, right? But the courts have, if you look at some previous cases, we find that there is the reappointment as cabinet minister again and again when he is not a member of the house, that the court has stated no to it, right? But in the recent case, we see that no, that the court did not abide by that, right? If you look at the Jayalalitha's case that was decided in 2001, wherein the court had held that a person, if he's otherwise disqualified, how can he be appointed as a minister, as a chief minister there? And eventually the court quashed the appointment. If you look at the recent ruling of the court in or from Maharashtra, what we the case for Maharashtra, what we see is that the person who's coming into power, or he's resigning and is being appointed as a minister, a person who is otherwise disqualified, you say that he can, the Constitution says that he can still be a member of the House for a period of 6 months. And so therefore he's put into the position of a cabinet minister. Would that be right if at all this Jayalalitha's case is relied upon, or which clearly mentioned that, it's if a person is otherwise disqualified, how do you appoint him as the chief minister? Now, in all of this tussle and in all of this, what is right and what is wrong with respect to the law at hand, we find Plato once again comes in, and he says that if you read his theory, what he's talking about is we need, people with a lot of integrity. We need judges who are men of the highest wisdom and infallibility of judgment. That is the level of the judiciary. The persons occupying the posts in the judiciary is what his expectation is, right? And Plato had so much faith in that he said that they should be people with you can confer on them huge discretion because they are persons of integrity. But when he was actually called upon to form a state in Syracuse, he found that this was the population that was missing. Like most of the people could not come up to the standards of that infallibility of that integrity he could not find. When we talk about the legislature has that interest of keeping itself that it should be a stable governance and that there should be stability so that there is a lot of work that gets done. They are making laws. So the expectation is, we also know that the doctrine of constitution trust, which trusts the legislature with lawmaking functions. So it has this whole process of how debates, discussions, and then a vote, and how a law has to be completely, it will come out to be a very good law. But what we see over here is issuance of whips, and then there is hardly any discussion that happens. We also know that the legislature is accountable to the people, right? And somewhere they have to go back to the people to say that this is what I have done. And we have the speaker, particularly a prime role to play with respect to anti-defection in the anti-defection law, as since he is the authority who will accept the resignation or not accept. And after the amendment, which said that the moment the resignation comes in, there will not be an automatic resignation. It will be a speaker will think over it or will ascertain whether it was voluntarily given, it's genuine or not, has left a lot of problems in this domain, right? I'm reminded of Rawls over here, who had stated that when you make the laws, better put the legislator behind veil of ignorance. He would not know what are the loopholes and he will have he wouldn't know where he stands, and therefore there would be a very good law. But that is of course a imaginary thing to happen. It may not actually happen. Plato stated that until philosophy and governmental power coalesce, there will be no end to evils in the state, right? Now, let us look at the third stakeholder, and that's the political parties. Constitution did not mention political parties anywhere. It was not mentioned, but elections in India has always been on the party lines itself. Later on, there was this symbol system that was evolved because we found that a lot of people in India, being illiterate, would not be able to understand which party the person. So if you put up a picture over there, the symbol over there, by that way, he'll be able to identify. I am stating that once again because to drive your mind to this fact that there is a party symbol, and we have thought over it that there is the party to which a party for which I'm voting, right? In 1989, there was this Representation of People's Act, and this Representation of People's Act was amended, and there is the Section 29A that was added, which talked about registration of political parties. So all of it was set right. Now, there is this political party who is interested in fielding candidates who are popular, who will win the elections, and thereby the whole party as such would be more popular, and they would be able to run the governance. So they will have power in their hands. They will be able to lead the state, right? That's the political party and its role in the whole of this process. We have the people's representatives. Their idea is to lead their constituency, to win the elections in their constituency. It is whether if they would not be a person who's being fielded by a party, they would have done it as an independent. So if a person is popular because of the kind of work that he has given to the society, he may think of not joining any party, and he may be contesting as an independent. But on many occasions, the party name also matters. So this person, what he is also applying for a ticket of a certain political party. And based on that, he is now contesting elections. So once he takes the help of the party, obviously the party also requires those. So that's give and take between the members as well as the political party. So So there has to be a solidarity between it, right? If I am taking a ticket from a party and I keep on blaming that party all the time, then the whole system will not work over there, right? So there has to be solidarity towards it. And whenever whips are issued, I should agree to that whip. And any deviation from there would be considered to be conduct, which is wanting to leave that particular party. Now, presenting a united front to the people as a political party that's a cohesive one is very important, because that's how people will have faith in you as a particular party who is popular and who can run. And if people fight amongst themselves, we feel that, okay, we cannot have, this group of people leading the state. So it's very necessary that, they put up a united front for the people. They are answerable to the House. They are answerable to the people as well. Now consider the electorate. That's the last stakeholder over there. The electorate is a body who, of course, it must be mentioned here that quite a huge lot of the population does not go for votes, right? Who does not vote. We find in villages, people vote more than in the cities. Now, do we vote for an individual or do we vote for the party? It cannot be denied that, we have not voted for the party. If you look at Avtar Singh versus Kuldeep Singh's case, wherein the person was openly criticizing his own government, the speaker held that a person getting elected as a candidate of a political party also gets elected because of the programs of that party. I have affiliation to this party because of which I got the derived the support, and that is why I won the election. Right. Now, if I leave the party, then should I not go back for permission to the electorate once again? Right. So if I've won the election from a Congress ticket, then I should abide by it. I have won the election, or people have consented to my leading them because I was a part of this particular party. Right. The moment I leave this party, somehow I need to go back to the electorate to seek their permission once again that are you still fine with me leaving the party and moving off? So when you look at the whole of the anti-defection law, we do find that it is pretty narrow as such, primarily maybe because the objective of the law was more towards having, a stability in governance and stability in the legislature. But somehow that voter is completely lost over there. He is not found in the whole of the process that goes on after the election results are declared. The quest for power is all that takes over everything. Correct. If you see what Aristotle has stated, he had stated that, laws should be made, the laws as this anti-defection as well. Laws would be pretty general. And you can't stitch the law to the very core for every problem that would arise at a later date. But for then you need very strong judges, where the judges decide based not on the letter of the law, but on many occasions based on what political justice would be and what the lawmakers. So what the judges would have to do then is actually put themselves in the position of the lawmaker to see, if I would be the lawmaker and this would be the problem, how would I have handled that problem? And then he would have to give his decision, right? So it's not just the stability that the law should be looking at. It should also be looking at the interests of all the stakeholders that are there. Now, if you take the Canada example, there is no botheration about people leaving one party and moving and joining another. There are so many countries that do not have an anti-defection law. It is perfectly possible over there. Once the permission or the consent of the people is for me to be representative of them, it is not associated so much with the party that if I leave the party, then I should, it is somewhat, I feel that you should go back for a re-election. Right. So only when we have, because since in India, we can't go back to a stage wherein that there is a no party system or that you segregate the two and you see that he's a representative of the people. So whichever party he's representing at that moment, it's immaterial. He's leading his and he's telling the legislature the viewpoints of his constituency, right? But we aren't at that stage. We have gone ahead, and now what we have to do is try to find out if that legitimate political authority, the person who's representing me, he gets his legitimacy from my vote, my consent, my approval, then somehow he should have to come back for my approval before if he is choosing to change his party. Other and till that point of time, complete stop to any activity, any public activity on his part, right? So we, but the problem is the ensuring of values, which is not so easy, right? When we talk about decision making in good faith, or the speaker deciding as to how the whether the resignation should be accepted or not. So a lot of areas that you will find where the problems are where the discretions are given. Now, when the discretion is given, how we utilize and how we use that discretion for the benefit of the people and for bringing in more of political justice is the need, is what we need to ensure, right? And with that, I am reminded of what Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar had stated, and with that, I conclude, however good a constitution may be, if those who are implementing it are good people, it'll prove, if are not good, it will prove to be bad. And however bad a constitution may be, if those who are implementing it are good, it will surely prove to be a good constitution. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for explaining the topic in simple words and with sagacity. Now, I would like to invite Mr. Gautam Bhatia to share with us his accumulated knowledge on anti-defection law. Mr. Bhatia.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm just going to take on from a few things that the professor highlighted. As she said, the purpose of the 10th schedule and the anti-defection law was to strike a balance between, on the one hand, the constitutional principle that the individual legislator represents their constituency and their constituent, and in that context has the freedom of conscience to disagree with the ruling party line on any issue based on what they think is good for their constituency and their function as a representative, on the one hand. On the other hand, the principle that if you stand on the ticket of a certain political party and sorry, is there some, if you're voted to power based on that political party, then defecting midway through is effectively a betrayal of the people's mandate. And so the 10th schedule strikes a balance in this way that it basically implicitly allows for disagreement and dissent to happen before the actual proceedings take place in the legislature. So you can disagree with your party heads and your party bosses, but once the whip is issued, once the vote happens in parliament or in the legislature, then you have to vote with the party. And then if you go against the party, it's treated as a defection and consequences follow. So that was the balance that was attempted to be struck in the 10th schedule. Now, what I'll be focusing is on is how recent events, specifically in Karnataka and in Madhya Pradesh, and the Supreme Court's response to those events through its orders and its judgments, have basically led us to a point where the original purpose of the 10th schedule and the balance that it meant to strike is presently undermined and is no longer actually serving that balance in any significant way. So it's important to understand first that there are multiple actors who are at play here, as Professor Shampa also pointed out. So it's of course the legislators who, you know, are the principal actors. At the same time, you also have the speaker, who is an important actor. And you also have, in recent cases, the governor, whose actions have led to important consequences. And then, of course, you have the court, whose job is to ensure that all these actors stay within constitutional bounds. Now, one thing that's it's important to understand is that the smooth functioning of parliamentary democracy depends upon constitutional conventions. Constitutional conventions are a set of uncodified norms that are sanctified by a long tradition of unbroken practice. Political functionaries tend to adhere to these norms, either out of a sense of public duty or out of a fear of paying a political cost by breaking those norms. Now, a written constitution like India's constitution can reduce the extent to which governments and governance rely upon conventions, but it can't eliminate them entirely. And that's some of the issues that we are seeing in recent months flow from those conventions that have not been able to be codified, and those gray areas in the text. And specifically when you have judicial review, when the courts are asked to rule on the bounds and limits of those conventions and the actors' actions, that leads to a further complication. And this depends in large part then upon the basic idea that the constitutional functionaries who are tasked with implementing constitutional conventions must be acting in good faith. So for example, parliamentary democracy vests substantial power in the office of the Speaker of the House. The Speaker of the House conventionally comes from the ruling party, but once they occupy the chair, they are expected to shed their partisan affiliations and impartially administer the rules of the House, including the conventions. The presumption of the Speaker's impartiality is the underlying basis for another very important constitutional convention, that courts shall not be called upon to adjudicate disputes relating to what goes on in Parliament. The Parliament has its own adjudicating authority, the Speaker, and the doctrine of the separation of powers requires courts to defer absolutely to how the Speaker manages the affairs of the House. However, once it becomes clear, as it arguably has become clear in recent months and years, that the Speakers quite often act in accordance with partisan motives, for example, on issues of certifying money bills, by refusing to hold votes of confidence, and so on, judicialization of the Speaker's conduct becomes inevitable. If opposition parties have good reason to believe that the game in the House is rigged, then they have little choice but to go to court. And then the court is faced with the impossible situation of balancing the imperative of staying out of Parliament's affairs, at the same time ensuring that basic accountability is maintained. A lot of these issues were visible in the whole set of events that happened in Karnataka recently that led to the toppling of the Congress JDS combined. So what happened there is now a familiar story, that a number of MLAs of the ruling combine offered their resignations to the Speaker. The result of this would be to deprive the ruling combine of its majority and offer the chance to the opposition BJP to stake a claim to form the government. Now the MLAs argued that they are resigning out of their own free will, while the Congress JDS combine argues that they have been bribed and threatened by the BJP to do so. And in fact, the very reason why they are resigning and not defecting is to circumvent the anti-defection law. Now at this point, Article 190 of the Constitution comes into play. Article 190 provides that MLA resignations are to be offered to the Speaker. It also allows the Speaker the discretion to reject the resignations if, in the Speaker's view, they are not voluntary or genuine. Article 190 therefore presumes that legislators act in good faith when resigning and makes the Speaker the judge of that. What Article 190 cannot do is to guarantee the Speaker themselves will also act in good faith when they adjudicate upon this issue. That presumption is a constitutional convention. Now, before the Supreme Court in that case, the legislators argued that the Speaker was deliberately delaying deciding on the resignation letters and thereby violating their duty to act in good faith. And so they asked the court to direct the Speaker to decide upon the resignation in a time-bound manner, which of course would require the court to get into affairs of the House. They also argued the Speaker was acting in bad faith and out of partisan motives, basically waiting until the ruling combine issued a three-line whip to the party members, at which point the anti-defection law would kick in. The moment the rebel legislators vote against the whip, the resignations would be infructuous because disqualification would kick in. So this was a situation in which the court was asked to rule upon and pass an order on what was happening. And the court's eventual order, unfortunately, in my respectful submission, actually did not sufficiently address the basic issue, which is the issue of horse trading. Because what the court did in that case was that it, on the one hand, it refrained from issuing any directions to the Speaker to decide upon the resignation and disqualification petitions. At the same time, it also held that until further orders, the 15 members of the assembly who had resigned ought not to be compelled to participate in the proceedings of the ongoing session of the House, and an option should be given to them that they can take part in the said proceedings or opt to remain out of the same. Now, as was pointed out at that time, the second part of this order effectively conflicts with the 10th schedule because it authorizes the rebel MLAs to disregard the party whip. So that was the core issue. Effectively, the court through an order circumvented the 10th schedule because then those rebel MLAs could refrain from following the party whip and not be disqualified. Now, the court's justification for this was that it was trying to find a balance and pass a balanced order. The question then arises, was this an adequate balance? The court's argument was that the speaker has the freedom to decide on the petitions pending before them, while the rebel MLAs have the freedom not to attend the proceedings of the House. That was what the court argued the balance was. However, if you scrutinize this more closely, you find that this balance is not a balance at all, as the second part of the order, which is on the issue of attending the proceedings of the House, effectively and presumptively holds the resignations to be valid until and unless the Speaker decides otherwise. This is because only if the resignations were valid would the party whip and thereby the 10th schedule cease to apply. In all other circumstances, the rebel MLA's defiance of the whip would be subject to 10th schedule disqualification. Now, the court specifically in that case noted in its order that the balance was occasioned by the fact that there was a trust vote the next day. Now, if this was the case, the court's apparent freedom to the speaker to decide on the petitions effectively was pointless, because the whole point was that the ruling combined, the Congress-JDS ruling combined, was likely to lose its majority in the circumstances that the rebel MLAs were able to defy the party without being disqualified, which is what the court's order allowed. So effectively, the order, while purporting to grant the speaker unlimited time, effectively only granted the speaker time till the trust vote to decide, after which time any decision the speaker would make would be infructuous for all practical purposes. So effectively, in my respectful submission, the effect of the court's order was to actually allow, if there was horse trading going on, to allow the horse trading to actually go on and eventuate in the toppling of the government and the replacement by the next government without an actual investigation into what was happening. And so this balance was in a way that effectively prevented judicial intervention into stopping and addressing the issue of horse trading. Now, something similar happened in the Madhya Pradesh case, which is of course more recent. And the Madhya Pradesh case also involved the governor's role here. And so again, I think everyone would remember what happened in the Madhya Pradesh case, but something similar happened. A number of MLAs from the ruling Congress party handed in the resignations. And this was around the same time that COVID had just struck. And so there was a lot of confusion. And at this point, the governor ordered a floor test to take place. And that governor's order was challenged before the Supreme Court. And there were a number of key questions that arose before the Supreme Court. The main issue was whether the governor of a state, who is, as we all know, a central government appointee, had the power to direct a convening of the assembly for the purposes of holding a floor test. The key question was whether this fell under the governor's discretionary power. That is to say that the general rule is that the governor can only act on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers, except where discretion is provided. The Supreme Court held that the governor's power to summon the assembly for the purposes of holding a trust vote did indeed fall within the governor's discretionary powers. Now, again, the basis of the court's judgment was that there is a constitutional principle whereby at all times the executive must be accountable to legislature, basic separation of powers. And if therefore the governor has reason to believe that the executive has lost the confidence of the House, then the governor can step in and direct a floor test for the limited purpose of determining whether or not the government continues to enjoy the confidence of the House. So that was the justification that the court gave. Now, again, the problem with this argument is that it also ignores one other important principle, which I mentioned earlier, which is that the supremacy of the legislature to determine the proceedings within the House and the supremacy of the Speaker to take calls on this issue of the confidence vote, designations, and so on. And it's important to note that there was a key distinction between what happened in Madhya Pradesh and what happened in Karnataka. And this distinction was drawn by Dr. Singhvi during oral arguments, that in Karnataka, the issue was government formation. But in Madhya Pradesh, there was already a government that was existing in power and functioning. And what was happening was that the composition of a functioning sitting house was altered because of the resignations of the MLAs. And so that was a key distinction that the court rejected, although it was drawn to their attention. Now, this distinction is important because the argument here is that the standard method of bringing down a government that has lost the confidence of the House is no confidence motion, can be circumvented either by an adjournment of the legislative proceedings or by the Speaker simply sitting on the no confidence motion, as actually happened with the previous NDA government, where the Speaker literally did not allow a no confidence motion to be voted upon. So therefore, the argument is that the governor is the authority to step in and ensure that doesn't happen. But what this argument ignores is that there is another solution to this issue, which is judicial review. So if actually the Speaker is sitting on resignations, and if the Speaker is refusing to hold a no confidence vote, then instead of having another political functionary, which is the governor, to intervene and add a second political actor to the proceedings, you can go to court and point out that this is a violation of constitutional principles. And after the recent judgment of the courts in the tribunal's cases, it's clear that the conduct of the Speaker can be subjected to judicial review. So that is no longer beyond the scope of what the court can do. So, but I think that what flows from these two situations, the Madhya Pradesh case and the Karnataka case, is that the court has chosen to refrain from actively intervening in these disputes around government formation, defections, resignations, and so on. And therefore, one possible solution, which is that the court would intervene to prevent or address horse trading, that seems to have no longer be open because the court has chosen to not be interventionist. And of course, there can be a debate about whether that is right or wrong. But that's what flows from these cases. So of course, then the question is what the solution to this might be. And here I'll just leave some suggestions and there can be a discussion on that. So one, of course, is making the anti-defection law stricter or stronger, you know, where in various ways you prevent the resignations from happening or attract them with disqualification. There are a number of issues with this, again, as we have discussed. There is also an important principle that legislators need to be able to act at least to some extent in accordance with what their conscience dictates. And the question is, how do you draw the line between that and horse trading, which, you know, where you have like threats or bribes that actually are responsible for these kinds of defections or resignations. A couple of other possible solutions. One is something along the lines of what is called the Fixed Term Parliaments Act in the UK, where you set the date for the next election in advance. It's not called by the executive, but it's set in advance. Now, in the UK context, you can still have a situation where a no confidence motion can be run and the government can fall even before that time. But maybe we should think about something along the lines of ensuring that once the government is constituted, then that government has to run its term for the next 5 years. unless, and there is an important exception in the Fixed Term Parliaments Act, unless 2/3 of the House votes for an early election. So in that case, you can have an early election and you can have like the government changing. But maybe we can think of a legislation or like a constitutional amendment that would prevent the government from changing if, as a result of resignations or defections, the composition of the House altered. So that could be simply something that we have made a big disincentive to legislators from shifting loyalties midway through the parliamentary session. The second thing, and I want to highlight this, is that one thing that I think people often make the mistake of doing is to look at anti-defection in isolation and just say, okay, should we weaken it? Should we strengthen it? What should we do? I think that that's a mistake, because you have to also see that where does horse trading come from, and where does it, why does it happen? I think as we've seen in recent months and years, in fact, a large part of it is huge financial incentives that are offered to switch sides midway through a parliamentary session. And if you think about it in recent years, a lot of that has been enabled by something like the electoral bonds scheme, which has actually resulted in a large amount of unaccounted donor money flowing to political parties. No one knows who is donating this money. No one knows how, we do know how much it is. It's a large amount. No one knows how it's being spent. And so I think that if you're able to have electoral reform that moves from this kind of huge amounts of unaccountable money flushing into the system and moves to a more transparent model of public financing of elections and political parties, then the money available for inducing legislators to jump ship, that there might be a way to tackle that. And if you tackle the root of the issue, you may be able to tackle or better address this issue of defections. So I think that ultimately there has to be a broader reform of the electoral system if you want to actually tackle defection. I think that making the law stronger or making the law, giving the law more teeth, is ultimately is going to be a temporary fix at best. Because what we have seen over the last few months is that just like through resignations, legislators can get around the defection, anti-defection law, and the court has its limits. It can't intervene beyond the point. Even if you make the law stronger, they will find some way of getting around it. So I think that ultimately the problem and its roots are a little deeper, and we need to go deeper to actually solve the issue. So with those suggestions, I'll bring it to an end and hand over to the next speaker.
Good evening, friends. Thank you for having me on this program. I think to understand the problem of anti-defection, we need to go back historically. And I would now take you to the Mundaka Upanishad. One of the mantras in that is Satyam Eva Jayate. And all of us know that Satyam Eva Jayate is our national motto. One more place where we have drawn from our ancient scriptures is Yato Dharmas Tato Jayaha. That is words attributed to Gandhari after she lost her 100 sons in battle, and she was told about it. And she says, where Krishna is there, that is where the Jaya is going to be. So there is Dharma. So this is the second portion. Now I take you to Ramayana, and Tulsidas ji said, Raghukula Reet Sada Chali Aayi, Pran Jaye Par Vachan Na Jaye. I'll take you to another writing from Kalidasa's Raghuvamsha, while describing the Raghuvamsha kings. In Shloka number 7, he starts by saying, Tyagaya Sampradartaya Satyaya Mitabhashinam. So Satya, this seems to be the key word everywhere. We are now faced with Asatya and Anruta everywhere. So how do we tackle it? Human ingenuity is such that whatever laws you make are easily circumvented. But let us look at our own constitution. The constitution was adopted on the 26th of January 1950. There was no need to introduce anti-defection legislation in the constitution till 1/3/1985, the 52nd Constitution Amendment. That means from 1950 to 1985, 35 years after the country was born, there was really no need for any such law. It was never felt that it was necessary. Then came the legislation. If you see the objects of this 52nd Constitution Amendment, and I quote, "It is likely to undermine the very foundations of our democracy and the principles which sustain it." That is the reason why this amendment became necessary of introduction. Now, the 10th schedule was introduced. Two amendments are introduced in Articles 102 and 191, both providing for disqualification. And Articles 75 and 164 providing that you cannot be a minister if you are disqualified. The problems that have come up in recent past arise on account of the ingenuity of our respected legislatures. Article 101 and 190 both talk of resignation. Now you see, if a person is in the house and if he does not follow the whip, it is written large that he is going to be disqualified. There's no such great explanation that is needed for it, because the 10th schedule is clear. The 10th schedule does not explain what is defection, though the title for today's topic is anti-defection. But the Constitution does not define defection, but it provides certain consequences of disqualification. So the 10th schedule provides what those qualifications are. If a person does not vote in accordance with the whip, or violates the whip, or does not attend, then it means that he is disregarding the party. See, the whole basis is this. You are given a ticket by a party. You are got elected on that party ticket. Therefore, you have to have loyalty to that party. Satya, yeah. Where is Satya? If you are a party person, and if your party tells you to do something, and if you act contrary to it. Now, that is where the catch lies. So if somebody wants to deliberately violate his own oath, and people don't act according to their conscience, then what happens? Now, you see, in the recent Karnataka imbroglio, large number of members of the Legislative Assembly tendered resignation. Now, I come to these two provisions, which are the bugbear. You see, they're in a way connected with anti-defection, but technically they're nothing to do with 10th schedule. You see, Article 101 and 190, both of these provide for resignation. Now, if a member of the Legislative House tenders a resignation by his hand, the Speaker has to only ensure that this designation is really given by him freely. That's all that inquiry is to be done. Now, in what we saw was that inquiry was deferred, and thereafter it was the matter went to court, and it's a long history, so I won't take you and bore you with all the facts of that case, because every right thinking person who reads the judgment and the way things went on in society, it's been a mockery of the entire system. Now, one other aspect which needs to be borne in mind is this, that if a person is elected on a ticket and he is in the house, if he honestly feels that what my party is doing wrong and I ought not to be part of this action that the party is taking, I don't agree with the party, then should he not have a freedom to resign? How can you prevent a person from resigning? Because if five people resign, majority is lost, the party in power is going to lose power. The object of anti-defection law is not to keep the party in power always. It is to ensure that persons who come to the house with a particular political backing, they don't abandon that backing for the purpose of the proceedings of the house. But it would be too much to expect that if a person is honestly in disagreement with the party, he should not resign. So there is now this horse trading is happening. I'll refer to some suggestions at the end of what I'm proposing to say. So Article 101 and 190 have some bearing on this. So we need to bear that in mind. Now, there are at least five or six leading judgments of the courts which have dealt with this. The earliest one is in 1992, where the constitutional validity itself was challenged in Kyoto Holohan, where the Supreme Court upheld the constitutional validity. But in that very first judgment, they forecast and they warned that speaker's integrity, speaker acting without bias, without favoring anybody, is a big question mark. That's what the Supreme Court has noticed it in 1992. Then we have Jagjit Singh versus state of Haryana. That is in 2006. In that judgment also, the Supreme Court repeatedly emphasizes that speaker has an important role, and being a party person elected at the support of the leading party in the House, would he be independent? Is the second judgment where this is noticed. More recently, Justice Nariman speaking for the Supreme Court in Kishan versus Manipur, 2020 Supreme Court cases, made a point that it's high time now. We have seen speakers are acting in this manner. Therefore, it's better that to have an independent tribunal. That's the suggestion from the court. Now, in addition to all these judicial dicta and pronouncements, we have also had the recent judgment in Patil's case where state of Karnataka was involved. And we all know what has happened in that case. There are several committees which went into it. The first was Dinesh Goswami Committee, Halim Committee. The Law Commission submitted a report in 1999. Honorable Justice Venkatachalaya's Constitution Review Committee submitted a report in 2002. All these are just carrying dust. Now, there are mischiefs. Now, if you look at it, the object of this webinar appears to be that we must focus on seeing what can we do about this? How do we tackle it? And I think I agree with my previous speaker that it is important for us to think of electoral reforms. One of the things that possibly has to be done is that no party or no individual should spend any money. At the time he or she files a nomination, there must be a fixed sum which they must pay to the state officially. And the state will provide all electoral California, including for all campaigns, everything. Not one rupee should be spent by the candidate. If the candidate has to go from one place to the other, car will be given by the state from out of these funds. That seems to be one way in which the entire thing will come into the record. And some basic electoral reform is necessary. You know, today we hear that even for corporate elections, for a corporator in city like Bangalore, I heard that they're spending something like 20 crores of rupees for an election as a corporator in one ward. I mean, it has reached such an absurd limit. So the thing is that one important aspect that we need to look at is what is the role of the speaker in this? And the speaker has to be independent. Supreme Court has said it so many times. So why do we not take note of it? Why do we not provide for it? So one suggestion in that context, which comes to my mind, is that the speaker has to decide. Now, for example, when a resignation is tendered, they can make a simple provision which says that the resignation letter must be submitted in person to the speaker by the member, unless the member is medically incapacitated, in which event the medical certificate to show that he cannot come may be annexed. So what is the verification for the speaker to do? The man is in front of you. He's telling you, sir, I don't want to be a member. You accept his resignation, then and there matter ends. Why do you dilly-dally? What is the kind of inquiry that you want to do? I want to verify whether he is really submitting the resignation. This is one. Second thing is to avoid this kind of a frivolous resignations on account of skipping party. I think there must be a very stringent penalty of 10 crore rupees for member of legislative assembly and at least 20 crore rupees for member of parliament who resigns during the tenure of his tenure. And that should be the amount which the state will spend to hold a fresh election. Now, this is something which the state is spending huge sum of money. This will have twofold effect. One effect is that it's a deterrent, that somebody cannot frivolously resign. Second is that the state is compensated by this if election has to be held. And maybe election has to be held for the entire assembly if there's hung assembly once again. So there has to be stringent consequences for this resignation. And another stringent consequence, I would say, is that if a person is found to have submitted a resignation for collateral reasons, then it should become a ground for disqualification. And disqualification does not mean, as the law now stands, till he is freshly elected again. It's become a mockery now. All the gentlemen who resigned in Karnataka, they're all ministers now. The next election, sub-election, by-election, they got elected and they're all ministers. So it was a promise given to them that you resign now, make the ministry go. We will come back to power because of the number game. And once we come back, you're all going to get back to power. This is absurd. So you must say that a person who resigns from the position or a person who is disqualified, he or she shall not hold any office of minister, nor shall he or she contest another election for a designated period of 5 years or maybe 10 years if it's disqualification. This will be a sufficient deterrent. Last submission that I have to make is the speakers, you know, no legislative assembly or parliament is going to allow some third party tribunal to come and judge over them, because our parliamentarians and legislatures think that they are supreme. No one can be above them. Therefore, we must work along with that to be a little practical. My suggestion is that the speaker should be, there must be a provision in the 10th schedule to say that before a speaker makes a decision, he or she should take the written advice of the State Election Commission or the Election Commission of India. Let a time bound direction, time schedule be there. The minute he receives a resignation, in 1 week's time, he should get a recommendation. Let that body independently, it's a constitutional body, they will give a recommendation. Based on that, the speaker will decide. Speaker must give a speaking order. He must give reasons. And one last safeguard, which will make sure, because courts have repeatedly said, every committee has said that something should be done. So my submission is that an appeal could be provided from the order of the speaker to the Honorable Governor. The Governor, it must be made clear, is not going to act on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers. He or she shall act in accordance with his own power, his own individual decision making. I think if these provisions are made, there is going to be substantial compliance with what we are thinking of as the various mischiefs that we have got. I think lastly but not least, Satyameva Jayate. I think I don't know how we are going to make our legislatures, with due respect to Sri Digvijay Singh Ji, who is very intently listening. I can only say, Namaskar, sir. It is for people like you who have to think now as to how we are going to infuse this concept of Satyam Vada Dharman Chara Swadhyaya Pravachanabhyam Na Pramaditavyam. This is what our Upanishad is saying every day. We are here. Taittiriya Upanishad is saying that. We are all having a hoary past in our country. How can we forget this? Ethics, morality, and our own conscience. If you mortgage your conscience, what remains? Nothing remains. You're not going to take anything from this world. When you're here, people should remember why Mahatma Gandhi is remembered now. Because of his book, My Experiments with Truth. Because of the fact that he stood by truth. So I think it's high time that we had some moral education for our legislatures. With these words, I thank you for hearing me patiently. And I hope I've made some effective contribution.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, Nagarajan sir, for sharing your words of wisdom in amending the electoral reforms and creating deterrence for MLA who resign. Actually, that is the central problem nowadays, and providing the practical suggestions, I'll say. Thank you so much, sir. And I also thank Mr. Bhatia, because I could not thank that time. So thank you so much, Mr. Bhatia, for scanning the anatomy of the existing problems lies in the decisions of then in the court and in the anti-defection law, and making wonderful suggestions. And now, I would like to invite Sri Digvijay Singh Ji to share his thoughts with us on anti-defection law. Sir.
Namaskar. Thank you very much for inviting me to this web seminar. And first of all, I would like to thank all the participants in this seminar who have given their views. And as a political person who first fought the election in 1977, probably Gautam may not have been born by then, but I totally agree with Mr. Naganand. Satyameva Jayate, as has been founded by our Upanishads, is something which has become almost non-existent in the present form of democracy. After we became independent, the framers of the Constitution chose parliamentary democracy as the form of government. Also, as the saying goes, the democracy is the least evil of all forms of governance. At the same time, we chose parliamentary democracy, and it goes to the credit of the constitutional framers and the giants of the freedom movement like Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Ambedkar, and others, who agreed for a parliamentary democracy to take roots in India. Till 1967, there was no problem. And 1967 onwards, we saw the coming of the Ayarams and the Gayarams. I recollect in 1967, in the Madhya Pradesh Vidhan Sabha, 37 of the sitting Congress MLAs defected and formed the Samyak Vidhayak Dal, which was a group of people who could not come to the in the cabinet, and the disgruntled elements came into formed a group and formed the government, which did not last very long. So then, of course, it became a farce in Haryana, where this phrase of Ayarams and Gayarams were coined. And I give credit to Rajiv Gandhiji. In fact, I was a member of parliament in 1985, and I voted for the constitution amendment for anti-defection law. But this anti-defection law has also now being circumvented by taking resignations of the people, of the MLAs, and then making them contest again. And huge sums of money are being offered. Now, as you pointed out about Karnataka, at least there was some semblance of dignity, where the MLAs who defected were not taken to the cabinet until they were elected. In the case of Madhya Pradesh, 14 of such people out of the 22 who defected have been made ministers without being in the assembly. See, there is a provision that anyone can be made as a minister for a period of 6 months. Then you have to get elected. But they have gone against the very, the essentials of anti-defection law. And 14 out of those 22 MLAs who defected have now become ministers without being an MLA. Now, horse trading is a reality. I was very disappointed by the role of the, with no offense meant to anyone, by the role of Honorable Governor and also of the Honorable Supreme Court. Everyone knew that huge sums of money have been offered, but they did not take into cognizance the ground realities, and they wanted to uphold the essence of the 10th amendment, the Constitution of Article 10. So therefore, I think this should have been taken into account. The 10th schedule should have been taken into kept in mind before they took the decision of getting a floor test. In fact, on the 16th, the assembly was called. The house, the governor's address took place. And because of the coronavirus, it was the house was adjourned for 10 days. Now, the right to call the house rests with the speaker after it has been called in order. So in this case, the house met on the 16th of March, and it was adjourned after the governor's address, and it was scheduled to meet on the 26th of March. Now, I feel that the speaker should have taken a stand that the court or the governor has no right to interfere in the functioning of the house. Unfortunately, that did not take place. And the speaker himself resigned and allowed the floor test to be done. The point I'm trying to make is that if there has to be a probity in politics, if there has to be, as Mr. Naganand says, Satyamev Jayate in the system and in the society, then in a democracy, the power sort of rests with the parliament and the assembly. And as per the Indian constitution, ultimately democracy, the people are the power. We the people, they have formed the constitution. But unfortunately, when the legislators or the members of parliament who have been elected by the people, without taking the people into confidence, unilaterally resign on their own because of obvious reasons. And you know, another farce took place in this case. The MLAs were confined to a hotel in Bangalore. They were not allowed to meet anyone. In fact, the Raj Sabha elections were on. And I was a candidate of the as a Raj Sabha, for the Raj Sabha. When I went to the to Karnataka, I requested the police, which was heavily guarded, formations were there for not allowing anyone to get into the hotel. So I had the right and the privilege to meet my voters, to ask for their votes. That was also denied to me. Now, another thing which happened was, they sent the resignation letters signed with one of the MLAs of the BJP, and he handed over the resignation letters to the speaker. Now, as has been held by the court, the speaker had the right to ask the MLAs to come in person so that he could decide on the decision of accepting the resignations by the MLAs. That also was denied because the MLAs were kept in captivity in Bangalore. I think there has to be a deterrent to stop this. This must be stopped. Otherwise, the democracy will not function. Sorry, I got a bad throat. So I strongly feel, as has been suggested, although Mr. Naganandji has suggested a very draconian kind of a thing of fines of 10 crores and 20 crores. But if you make it mandatory, as has been recommended in the report of the National Commission to Review Working of the Constitution under Justice Venkatachalaiyaji, that the incentive to the MLAs to defect is to get a position of power by defecting to another party. So the recommendation was that the person who defects should not be allowed to hold a position of power or office of profit till the tenure of the existing house. So therefore, if that happens, or alternatively, he should be disqualified for not holding the position for the next 6 years, like this disqualification in the People's Representation Act. But there is a dire need to look into the electoral reforms. This cancer of defection has to be eliminated from the body politic of this country. Even in a fractured mandate, although there is a recommendation of the Sarkaria Commission that the single largest party must have the option to form the government. And if they fail to muster a majority in the House, then the second option could be looked at. But in the case of Goa, Mizoram, Nagaland, it has been violated by the ruling party, of course, with the connivance of the Honorable Governor. So therefore, I think to bring probity in public life, there has to be some rethinking on the anti-defection law. And the Prime Minister, although I'm not very sure whether he would do it, but at the same time, I would strongly advise and recommend that all party meetings should be called at the national level so that we can fight this cancer of defection and bring probity in public life. So the other thing which I wanted to point out is the sort of the right of the speaker within the assembly and the parliament. I strongly feel that the court's intervention in the functioning of the assembly and the parliament should not be allowed. After all, but at the same time, the speaker has to act judiciously. Although we are all political persons, and even the speaker belongs to a political party, but still I feel that he should have the conscience to act as per the law and as per the power that has been given to him by the constitution and by the law. So therefore, this right of the speaker in going through the process of taking resignation and accepting the resignation has to be formulated in a manner, but it should be kept out of the jurisdiction of the court. I agree with the young man, Mr. Gautam Bhatia, when he talks of electoral reforms. I agree with Mr. Naganandji that I was in charge of Karnataka for some time and Andhra Pradesh also for some time. Can't imagine the kind of money that is being spent in municipal corporation elections, in assembly elections, in parliament elections. I would not like to quote figures because that may not be the right thing to do on a public platform. But I endorse what he has said about Bangalore municipal corporation elections. So therefore, I think there is a need for electoral reforms. Although the election commission puts up chartered accountants where the candidate has to file returns on a daily basis on the amount of money spent. And the whole system has to be worked out by the candidate to sort of submit his returns as honestly as possible. But how can you fight in a present system election in the prescribed amount of money that is sanctioned for each parliament seat or for the assembly seat? So there is certainly a need for electoral reforms. Gautam referred to the election bonds. I think he's 100% right. The ruling party has definitely got an added advantage where the corporates can give huge sums of money without being noticed. So therefore, in totality, I would like to support and the argument that the to bring probity in public life, there has to be a rethinking on the issue of the anti-defection law, and a greater deterrence has to be placed, whether penal provisions or not allowing the person who's defecting to get a position of power either for 6 years or at least by till the end of the term which is he's a member, and also at the same time some kind of electoral reforms where all these practices could be controlled. With that, I would like to conclude. I won't take much of your time, but I would be very happy to sort of reply if anyone has a question. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for giving deep and practical insight into the topic. Now, there is a one question to Mr. Gautam, Mr. Nagananda, and to Digvay sir. Mr. Bhatia, I'll just unmute you. I think Just a minute. Yeah, is this okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so the question is from Apurva, that whether in crossing the floor to punish an elected representative for what really amounts to an expression of conscience negates the very democratic principle which the 10th schedule preserve and sustain. And with this, how will you protect the interest of honest dissenters and conscientious objectors? Like, where to draw the line, how to protect the interest of honest people who really wants to defect because their political party is not doing good?
Yeah, I mean, so I think that is the core issue, and that has been something that we've addressed in different ways. I think that I think, as someone has pointed out, the thing is, if you're resigning for your conscience, right, it doesn't then follow that you resign and then join the rival party, right? Because then that clearly isn't an expression of your conscience, but something else altogether. So if the purpose of your resignation is your conscientious disagreement with what your party is doing, then you should have no objection to not being in the legislature for the foreseeable future. And so, like, a disqualification that is of a sufficient period of time should not be a problem for you. That's one thing. And I think secondly, as I think also people have pointed out, the speaker's office should be strengthened and made impartial, and the speaker should then have the right to adjudicate upon whether the resignation is actually a question of conscience or something that has been obtained through either pecuniary offers or through blackmail. So I think that if you have these two safeguards along with electoral reform, then you can be, you're able to, like, draw that line between expressions of conscience and other kinds of resignations.
Okay, thank you, Gautam. Now, there's a question from Amit Elim to Mr. Nagananda, that I'm just first unmute Mr. Nagananda. Just give me a minute. Yes, sir. Okay, so is it safe to say that there's a need for a legislation to control the numbers and degrees of whips issued by political parties? This is the first question.
That can't be done. You see, it's the political party which decides on which issue they must issue a whip and how their party members must vote. So I think that does not seem to be practical. Also, it would be against the democratic functioning of the houses. You know, houses have to decide. And if important issues come, you can't have a number of restrictions. Number restrictions, not practical, not permissible.
Okay. Sir, another question to you is that what is your suggestions for expelled members who are expelled from the party but are still governed by anti-defection law? Whether amendment is required in that respect?
No, person, as I understand it, if he is expelled from the party, he loses his post. So he is not being expelled. Supposing a person is expelled for anti-party activities, as they call it, a euphemistic term, which I still haven't understood what it means. But anyway, that is used very frequently. So if somebody is expelled for that reason, then it is not that he is expelled because of defection. So therefore, I think these provisions may not apply in a case like that.
Thank you so much, sir. So there's one question to Digvijay, sir. I'll just unmute him. The question is, if floor crossing by one member is an evil, then a collective perpetration of it by one third of the elected members of a party is no better and should be regarded as an aggravated evil, both logically and from the part of its aggravated consequences. Whether it should be, it should not be removed from the 10th schedule?
See, now it has been amended. Now it has been amended. It's two-third now.
Yes.
Brought in by Mr. Atal Bihari Vajpayee in 2000.
Yes.
So the fact remains, this is just an additional deterrent for the kind of things happening which have happened in Karnataka and Madhya Pradesh. So if the 2/3 of the members of the assembly of a political party, if they are so unhappy with that political party, if they want to sort of defect, then that should not be, they should not be be within the ambit of being disqualified. So therefore, I think this is fine. But I would like to also comment on the earlier question of the, on the issue of conscience. Well,
yes.
Such a conscientious member or any member of the assembly has got the inherent right to resign. Now, if he is resigning on any on the issue of conscience, then what is the big idea of taking the office of prophet and moving on to a different political party simultaneously? So therefore, when if there's a really issue of conscience, then he has the right to resign and wait till the next election to fight from that seat. But at the same time, I would strongly again advocate that any person who has been elected by a political on the for a particular party platform should be denied the right to get into a ministry or take a post of prominence or office of profit. That should be totally denied till the term of the present of the existing legislature or parliament.
Okay, sir, there is a question to Digvay sir only. Is defection an issue because people are unable to completely devote themselves to a particular party's ideology?
Well, the point is, why did he join that political party if he's not agreed to, if he doesn't believe in that ideology? Unfortunately, ideology has taken a back seat in today's politics. While it should be the first thing, if you don't have the ideology, if you don't agree to the ideology of a particular political party, why have you joined it? And if the party is deviating from the known ideological stand of a political party, then he has a right to differ and protest. But if that is not so, then any kind of defection or a deviation or a changing party without the issue of ideology is, I think, against the very principles of democracy and Satyameva Jayate issue, as Naganaji has said.
Sir, there's one more question to you. As you said that judicial intervention should not be allowed in legislature matter, what can be the deterrence for the speaker if he, on the face of it, acts malafide?
See, the House is the authority which has to contain and control the acts of the speaker also. There is a provision in the rules that if the speaker is not acting according to the rules, then they can then go for a no confidence motion against the speaker himself and vote him out.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
There is a question to Mr. Bhatia. Gautam, how do we ensure that dissenters are not held hostage by the party horse trading these MLAs, MPs from Anirudh Barua?
No, I think that's the same question as last time. My response is the same, that you can have mechanisms, and as Digvijay sir also suggested.
That
you can weed out the dissenters from the people who are crossing the floor for pecuniary or other reasons. Because if you are dissenting, then you obviously you're not interested in the other political party, or you're not interested in a ministerial post, right? You should have no problems with being disqualified from the House until the next election comes. So I think that can very quickly sort out this whole issue. And I think I think until electoral reform takes place, the incentives to defect will remain, these huge amounts of money. So until you sort that out, I think any other fix will be a temporary fix. It won't be a permanent fix.
Okay. Thank you, Adam. Okay. Yes, sir. Yes.
The question of whether the speaker and his decisions should be left to the House. Digvijay Singh ji just made a point that if the speaker takes wrong decision, he can be impeached and his position can be removed. But really speaking, you know, I think the speaker belongs to the majority party. So if the speaker's decision suits the majority party, why will the majority party take any action? They will never pass a no confidence motion against him. And also there may be situations where the House is equally divided and this decision of the speaker itself has tilted the balance. And I think it is now well settled by a catena of decisions of the Supreme Court, where they've said that when he is acting under the 10th schedule, then his action is like a tribunal, and the tribunal is amenable to judicial review. Of course, the judicial review is very, very limited, and courts have always looked at it with great circumspection and found out whether many times the speaker's decisions have been accepted and upheld also. So I think to that extent, you see, today, whether you like it or no, all other organs of the state have to come under the overarching arm of judicial review. Whether the court is always right, it's not right, it's going too far, it's not going too far, those are matters of individual cases. But I think in the overall polity of things, it seems to be that that may be appropriate. That's my view. Thank you.
Okay. I think Digvijay sir wants to say something. Yes, sir.
See, with all humility, I would like to sort of react to what Mr. Naganandji has said. You see, you can fix a certain timeline under which the speaker has to decide one way or the other. And as I've seen lately, the speakers, when they don't want to take a decision, there is no timeline fixed under the Act as to they have to decide within a certain timeline. So I think without questioning the authority of the speaker and bringing him to the in the purview of the judicial review, I think what is it, what can be done is to bring a provision in the anti-defection law that there has to be a certain time frame in which he has to take a decision one way or the other and not keep it pending for a long time.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. I think, is there any other speaker who wants to add something to this? Okay, so since we have taken enough questions now, and we are on the verge of ending this session, thus, on behalf of NEEV Judicial Education, I would like to thank Shri Digvijay Singh Ji, Shri S.S. Nagaran Ji, Mr. Gautam Bhatia, and Dr. Dev Shampa for taking out time from their busy schedule and enriching us with their knowledge, wisdom, and experience, and giving the practical solutions and suggestions. I also thank the audience for their question and participating in the webinar. I also thank Dr. Vinod Sharma for being the backbone of NEEV. I further thank the entire team of NEEV Judicial Education for bringing such an impressive panel together. Thank you. Thank you so much for your presence, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.